Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here this afternoon for what promises to be a fantastic presentation. And thank you to the Global Health Diplomacy Speaker Series and the Office of Global Health Diplomacy for hosting this very, very special event. We are honored today to welcome Dr. Jane Goodall to the State Department. Dr. Goodall is considered to be the world's foremost expert on chimpanzees and has dedicated her life to studying and protecting their behaviors and their habitat. Her animal welfare and conservation research and advocacy efforts have earned her numerous honors and awards, including the French Legion of Honor, the Medal of Tanzania, and Japan's prestigious Kyoto Prize. In 2002, Dr. Goodall was appointed to serve as a United Nations Messenger of Peace, and in 2003, she was named a Dame of the British Empire. Through the Jane Goodall Institute, Dr. Goodall continues to be a global leader, spearheading an approach that recognizes innovative, community-centered conservation and development programs in Africa. Thanks to Dr. Goodall, we have a better understanding of the role individuals can play in supporting a better, healthier planet. She embodies the power of one person's ability to change the world. Like Dr. Goodall, the United States believes that health, gender equality, education, and environmental sustainability are fundamentally important and must be integrated into all of the work that we do. And today's presentation couldn't come at a more timely moment as the world looks to implement the recently adopted global goals. And in December, the world will come together again in Paris to negotiate a milestone commitment to combat climate change. We know the world's development gains cannot be maintained without addressing climate change and promoting a healthy environment. Dr. Goodall, on behalf of the State Department, thank you for your tireless leadership and advocacy and for being here today to share your thoughts with us. As you can see, we have a packed room and we had a few hundred people on a list who wanted to come but who will get to see this broadcast later. So I know that I speak for the entire State Department when I express our delight in having you here today. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Goodall.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for a wonderful welcome. And I've already met several of you in private meetings and photograph sessions and things. And I'm very happy to be here. And yes, the Jane Goodall Institute is doing as much as we can. And the reason that we're successful is we have wonderful people on our team. And I'm very happy to see two of our board members sitting down in the front, Keith Martin and David Shear. And we have members of the staff. We have Mary Humphrey, Susanna Name, Sean Sweeney, and Tammy Palmer, who you will be seeing a little bit more of later. Because what we've planned to give you today is what I'm going to call a Tammy sandwich, which means that I'm going to make some remarks, and then Tammy will come and fill in some of the details which we thought might interest you from one of our programs to do with women's health and the environment. And then I'm going to come back and talk about the future. Is there hope? So let me start, obviously, as I began, which was having a childhood dream, getting out to Africa, meeting the late Louis Leakey, having the opportunity to go and study chimpanzees who happened to be our closest living relatives, finding over time that biologically they differ from us by only just over 1%, show many behaviors similar to ours. They're capable of using and making tools, gestures and postures such as kissing, embracing, holding hands, patting one another, shaking the fist, doing all these in the same context as we do. Finding there are these close, long-term bonds between family members that can last through a life of up to 60 years in the wild. Finding, to my horror, they have a dark side, as we do, and are capable of violence, brutality, and warfare. But also, like us, They're capable of love, compassion, and altruism. And so all of these similarities given, there are clearly differences. And I think that if I'm asked to pick the most significant difference between chimpanzees, other animals, and ourselves, it would be the explosive development of the human intellect. We have to admit today that chimpanzees, along with many other creatures like elephants and whales and so on, are far more intelligent than was admitted when I first began studying chimpanzees in 1960, when I was told at university that the difference between us and the other animals was one of kind. In fact, it's just one of degree. But it's a rather major degree, this human intellect of ours. And it's taken us to the moon, it's taken us deep under the sea. It's capable of extraordinary feats. And so the big question is, how is it possible that the most intellectual creature to ever walk planet Earth is destroying its only home? The photographs obtained by that little robot that's crawling around the surface of Mars make it very clear that that planet is not a very hospitable environment for human colonization. We have to make do with planet Earth, and planet Earth has finite natural resources, and our human numbers are ever growing, and our, I would say, theft of natural resources from the planet grows apace. It was Mahatma Gandhi who said, "This planet can provide for human need, but not human greed." And when I talk about the fact that we're harming this planet, I think you all know exactly what I'm talking about. Talking about deforestation leading to desertification, talking about the shrinking freshwater supplies around the world, talking about the pollution of air, water, and land, the industrial, agricultural, and chemicals, industrial, agricultural, and household chemicals that are polluting the land, leaching down into the streams, gradually ending up in the ocean. We're seeing loss of biodiversity around the world. We're seeing the terrible poaching of elephants, rhino, tigers, and the live animal trade and the poaching to steal parts of bodies for sale. In addition to all of this, we're now faced with the challenge of climate change. Yes, there's going to be a meeting in Paris. I hope that it will be a very, very binding agreement from the nations of the world, but we're not there yet, and the problems are huge. So, as you all know, it's the destruction of the forests that is impacting climate change, because forests are one of the great ecosystems that sequester CO2 from the atmosphere and sequester it in the trees and in the forest soils. And the other great ecosystem is the ocean. And both of these great ecosystems are now comprised. And so the greenhouse gases emitted by reckless burning of fossil fuels, emitted by the billions of farm animals that are being raised for consumption, which is, for one, causing huge areas of forest to be destroyed to grow grain to feed them, and for two, they are producing a very large percentage of the methane that is an even more potent greenhouse gas than CO2. Can we carry on like this? It was when I flew over the little Gombe National Park, where I'd been studying chimpanzees since 1960, and I flew over in a small plane in the early 90s, and I looked down, and I was shocked. I knew there was deforestation around Gombe. I wasn't prepared to look down on completely bare hills. And it was very clear that there were more people living there than the land could support. They were too poor to buy food from elsewhere. The soil had been over-farmed and had become unproductive. People were struggling to survive. And that's when it hit me. There's no way we can even attempt to save these precious Gombe chimpanzees, only about 100 of them, who are then completely cut off from others of their kind by these bare hills. There's no way we can even try to save them unless we can improve the lives of the people living around that last little oasis of forest. And so that began the program that we call Take Care, or TACARI. And it began not in the way that so much well-intentioned but unfortunate aid has been delivered. It wasn't a bunch of white people arrogantly going out to these villages and telling them what we were going to do to make their lives better. I was working with, he was a genius really, George Strunden, who'd been 17 years in that part of Tanzania. And he picked a team of local Tanzanians. None of them had PhDs, but they'd all worked for NGOs in health, in agriculture, and in education, particularly one who was involved in forestry. And they went into the villages, this little team, and they sat and listened. They listened to the elders, they listened to the women. They asked them, what do you think we can do to make your lives better? And they said, first of all, we need to grow more food. And you know, the thing is that poverty is a huge force in the destruction of the environment, because when you're very poor, you're going to cut down the last trees in order to grow food to feed your family. So they wanted to grow more food, and we addressed that by restoring fertility to the overused land, because there were really no more trees to cut down unless they went into the national park, which was what we were trying to save. And we did this without using chemicals, partly because we couldn't afford it. We had a very small grant from the European Union, and we were doing this pilot study in the 12 villages around Gombe National Park. And the second thing they wanted was better health facilities. The third thing was better education for their children. And so we tackled these two wants of theirs by working closely with the local Tanzanian government and improving the clinics that were there that were without very much equipment, and adding a classroom, perhaps funding a teacher, these kinds of things. And as these programs began to work, so people began to trust us, and we were able to introduce programs to provide clean, hygienic water to the villagers and hygienic latrines. And then we introduced what I believe has been one of the most successful aspects of all, and that was microcredit. And it was based on the Grameen Bank of Muhammad Yunus. And he took me to Bangladesh and introduced me to the women whose lives had changed through microcredit. And so, based on the Grameen Bank model, we have 9 little microcredit banks in the area where we work, and groups of 5 women who can be joined by 2 men, but mostly the men don't particularly want to join 5 women, so it's mostly just the 5 women, and they have to select environmentally sustainable projects for the tiny loans that they take out, like buying a few chickens to sell the eggs, like growing a few seedlings to sell to the various farms, these kind of projects. And then if the money is paid back, and about 80% overall has been paid back since the end of the 90s, they can take out a larger loan. And when they don't pay back, it's usually because there's been a death or something, not through any kind of misbehavior. So microcredit was empowering women, and this became something that was clearly very important. We followed that up with programs for women's reproductive health and family planning. Family planning, which was well received by the villagers. The reason all the trees had gone, the reason the land was overused, was the sheer numbers of people. And it may surprise some of you to hear that even men began coming to ask for vasectomies. People realize they cannot continue to support this number of children. In the old days, the children would go off and do their own farms, and that was fine, but now there were no land to give the children, so they went into the cities, tried to get a job, usually failed, came back to share the last little piece of land with their aging parents. So empowering women, providing scholarships to keep girls in school past the difficult time of puberty, that's why the hygienic latrines are so important. This turned out to be one of the best things we did, because all around the world, it's been shown that as family size decreases, that it decreases as women become better educated. So this holistic approach to really conservation worked. And I'm going to come back and tell you how it worked for conservation after the Tammy part of the sandwich. Tammy is going to talk to you about the work that we do in Democratic Republic of Congo, DRC, that built upon the experience that we gained with our Tukari program in Tanzania.
Good afternoon. As Jane mentioned, within the Jane Goodall Institute, we lovingly refer to this model where Jane begins, she whets your appetite, she stretches your imagination, she introduces a member of her team to talk more deeply about the programs, and then she comes back to give us reasons for hope. We call that the sandwich. As Jane mentioned, personally, I've begun to refer to it as the setup, because how do you speak after Jane Goodall? But I'm up for the challenge today. And so, of course, you know about Jane Goodall's iconic research and insights into the chimpanzees of Gombe. You're probably familiar with Jane's work as a UN messenger of peace, but what you may not be as familiar with is the insight that Jane talked about that crystallized in her mind as she actually took that flight over the Gombe Hills. What she saw is that in 1993, the hills were deforested as a result of intensive and unsustainable land use practices. And what Jane said, and this is really important for the Jane Goodall Institute today, until we put people at the center of conservation, we will not conserve the environment. And so today I want to talk with you really briefly about one example of how we are putting Jane's insight into action as the Jane Goodall Institute. And for that, we're going to turn to Eastern DRC. So very quickly, I just want to orient you geographically. Gender, health, and conservation is one of six program areas that we have at the Jane Goodall Institute. All of our activities connected to gender, health, and conservation primarily take place within the geographical zone that's highlighted by the yellow circle there. So we're talking about going from Goma and the easternmost part of the country all the way up to Lobutu going towards the West via Walikale. The only other piece of information that I would highlight on this particular slide is that all of the little pop-up windows that you see there, it demarcates areas or the presence of armed forces, national forces, external forces to the DRC. To make an understatement, this is a very complicated area to implement. So I'm going to talk to you about the human-chimpanzee connection through the lens of disease. And so I also want to talk about how we wrap our programs around that connection in order to improve outcomes that are specifically related to gender, health, and conservation. So of course, most of you are probably aware that diseases between chimpanzees and human beings exist. Because of our genetic similarity to chimpanzees, the diseases and the known diseases that infect human beings also similarly infect chimpanzees. And chimpanzees pick up germs just like we do. They pick up germs by manipulating infected objects, by breathing contaminated air. And so when we see the frequency of interaction increasing between chimpanzees and humans, obviously chimpanzees are more vulnerable to those diseases. And I'm talking about diseases like the common cold, Ebola, human respiratory illnesses, pneumonia, typhoid, cholera, etc. So through numerous baseline studies that we've conducted in the Democratic Republic of the Congo in the areas that we target, what we've honed in on as an institution is that the communities that we are working in don't have access to potable water or drinking water. In conducting those surveys, we found that the incidences of diarrhea, for example, were as high as 46% in 10 target villages. The incidence of cholera as high as 25% in those villages. So what did we do? In 2013, we began a program to increase access to potable water. And the theory of change that we have is clearly laid out in the graph that's behind me. So the assumption is that more potable water in communities near chimpanzees will over time lead to reductions in waterborne diseases. Then you have improvements in human health. And over the long run, we begin to see more healthy chimpanzee populations that are near to human populations. So we work in those communities that are closest to those chimpanzee communities. So we're talking about co-location. So here's a picture of one of those 10 target villages that I mentioned. This is a village of Burue in the eastern DRC. The picture's not coming out quite as clearly here, but this is an example of a water source prior to JGI's intervention. It's just an open spring that is located in a forest. This is what we now have in Burue Village as a result of JGI's interventions. Under a 3-year project that began in 2013, it will be coming to a conclusion very soon in 2016, we implemented a program with $2.5 million targeting those 10 communities in Walikale and Lobutu that I mentioned. Some of the results that we've seen under this program is that now in this community, specifically in Burue, 3,000 individuals now have access to potable water. And the next impact or result that I'm going to talk about is really important in terms of gender. So the distance traveled now for women and girls who are collecting water, because for those of you who work in sub-Saharan Africa, you know that the task of collecting water is borne principally by women and young girls. So that distance has been reduced from 2 kilometers to 100 meters in this particular community. That is critical when you think about the personal safety issues that are associated with women going from their communities into forested areas in a highly conflicted zone. There are other results that I could share with you if I had more time, but let me just say that at the end of this project, we will see 102,000 individuals having increased access to health facilities that are also supported by this same program. I love this picture. This is a photo actually taken around a family sensitization training, a family planning, I should say, sensitization training. The reason that this picture engages me is because he is leaning in. He's all in. And very much so engaged himself with this process. As Jane mentioned, one of the areas of intervention for us is family planning. And though I don't have the time to go into it in detail, I will say that one of the misconceptions about unmet contraceptive needs in sub-Saharan Africa is that because contraceptives are not available, people cannot avail themselves of those contraceptives. But actually, when you look at the research of the Guttmacher Institute, the number one reason that women are not using contraceptives, according to this research, is the fear of health risks. They fear that by taking the contraceptives, they themselves will not be healthy. So this type of dramatization is critically important in terms of educating those populations and helping to break down those barriers in terms of misinformation. Now we're going to go and zoom out and look a little bit at JGI's breach. For those of you who may not be aware, JGI currently has field offices in Tanzania, in Uganda, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Congo. The other countries that are highlighted here are part of our 30-year vision as an institution. Our 30-year goal is to conserve chimpanzees in their natural habitats at least, at the very least, 85%. So I'm going to end where I began and also where Jane began as well, by showing you the heels of her beloved Gombe that she talked about. So this is one village, Kigalye village, or Kigalye village, depending on your pronunciation. And this is what Jane saw when she flew over the hills of Gombe. Notice how scarred the hills look. Notice how denuded they look. So as she mentioned, our community conservation approach began from her insight here. In 2013, this is what those same hills looked like as a result of about 10 years of very protracted community-centered efforts. It's an approach that Jane endorses because it works. And with that, I leave you and end my part of the Tammy sandwich and invite Dr. Goodall back to the stage.
Well, thank you, Tammy. I think all of you probably agree that success comes with teamwork. None of us can do anything alone, and the team that we build around us makes all the difference in the world. So thank you, Tammy. A nice, juicy middle to this sandwich. I'm glad that you put these slides up, because that's where I want to pick up. I want to go back to the program that began in 1984, this Takari program that's actually led to these other areas where JGI operates, which has helped us to understand the importance of working with the villagers. They've become our partners. How did that happen? That second slide where you saw the trees, what happened to make that a possibility? Well, I explained what we did, explained how we gradually introduced other components, empowered women and so on. And then we brought into our team a remarkable person, a remarkable scientist. I wish he was here this morning, but he's not, Lillian Pintea. And he is a specialist in this satellite imagery. He creates high-resolution photographs where you can see every tree. He's managed to introduce us to Esri, to Google Earth, to Digital Globe that provides the imagery for Google Earth, and now most recently to NASA. And these organizations have provided us with hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of software and expertise. So what happened was that Lillian could go out to the villagers around Gombe, who were all required by the Tanzanian government to set aside 10% of land for conservation, but most of them were paying no attention to that. They didn't even know about it. And they were required to make village land use plans. And that was costly because Tanzania required all the different stakeholders to be part of those meetings. And they had no proper maps. So now there are wonderful pictures of Lillian sitting down with the village elders, and they've got these maps. And one woman said, "That's the tree I put my baby under when I work in the fields." And so they were able to make these detailed land use management plans. And of course, the bare hills were caused in many cases by farming in very unsuitable areas, like the steep slopes. This is part of the rift escarpment. And obviously, that was the least used to them for farming. And so that was the first land they put aside for conservation. And there is all this magic I'm always talking about in seeds, in plants, in life, the resilience. And so these seeds that had been lying dormant began sprouting. And the result was the tree cover that you saw in that second slide. And that's happened all around. And it's happening not only in those 12 villages around Gombe. It's happening in villages further away, because obviously tree cover in hilly country is important for various things, to prevent the soil erosion, which in turn was silting up the streams. And so gradually the people came to trust us more. And now with these maps, with the land set aside, with the trees come back, there's a buffer between the Gombe chimpanzees and the villagers, which is very good for the transmission of disease as well as the safety of both chimps and people. And the chimpanzees in the whole area have 3 times more forest than they had when we began the program. So very successful, but it goes on from there. We're now in 52 villages. In the south part of Tanzania, the forests are still relatively intact, and there are more chimpanzees living there, but they're not protected by law. And so we use the same type of program to restore the trees around Gombe and to protect the forests in the south. Well, so people say, but how do you know this is really working? Of course, we have the aerial maps, but we also have another tremendous advantage. Each of these 52 villages has volunteered 1 or 2, depending on the size of the village, forest monitors, villagers to be trained as forest monitors. And Lillian and his colleagues have conducted workshops. And sometimes these villagers can't read or write, but Google Earth has provided tablets. And they've sat around together at these workshops and worked out what they would like to record, what impacts, adverse impacts made by humans would they record, a trap, a discarded cartridge, a tree illegally cut down. But they also decided, well, we're going to record chimpanzee nests because they make beds in the trees at night. We're going to record if we find a leopard track. We're going to monitor the health of these forests and see how it changes over time. They're proud of this work, and the big advantage, because it's GPS, we know that they've been where they say they've been, because the map tells you where they've been. And all of this information is going up to one of these platforms in the clouds. I mean, clouds apparently mean something different to what I grew up with. And the idea of putting a platform in a cloud seems crazy to me, but there are, as you know, platforms in the clouds, and this is Global Forest Watch. So that data becoming available to everyone. That's how what you saw happened. The villagers have become our partners, and they are proud of the work that they do, and they understand the importance of conserving the environment. How much hope do we have for the future? I mean, I've heard a number of scientists talking, addressing crowds, and basically saying, we've gone so far in our destruction of the planet with climate change following the trajectory that's been estimated, we may as well give up. We don't have that much time left before the climate of the planet is unsustainable for the kind of life that we all want to lead, and that a great deal more biodiversity is disappearing faster and faster. And yes, we're in the midst of the 6th great extinction. Well, one of the reasons for hope is the one I've just given, the resilience of nature. The fact that if we give nature a chance and maybe some help, it can be restored, not quite as it was before, but it can once again sustain life. Animal species on the brink of extinction can be given another chance. I wrote a whole book called Hope for Animals and Their World, and it's unbelievably inspirational because every chapter is about an animal species that would not be with us but for a group of passionate biologists or conservationists who decided not on our watch. And there are chapters, too, on the resilience of nature in restoring places like around Gombe. So that's one of my reasons for hope. But then I come to another aspect of JGI, which to me is maybe the most crucial, and that is youth. We can all fight, and I know the great work that you're all doing in the State Department, which is involving environment, women's health, and so forth. But we might as well all give up if new generations are going to make exactly the same mistakes as we've made, if they're not going to be better stewards of planet Earth than we've been. And it was because I was meeting so many young people, high school, university students from all parts of the world. And let me back off one second here, because I've just remembered something that's interesting for you all. And that's when I first realized that forests were disappearing across Africa and chimpanzee numbers were plummeting. That was in 1986. And I decided I would have to go around some of the range countries and talk about these problems and try and find out what, if anything, could be done. And you know who made that trip possible for me? It was then Secretary of State James Baker. I was here in this building, and then he invited me to a lunch, and I was talking about this. And so he sent, young people don't even know what telex is these days, I think. He sent a telex to all the embassies in the chimp range countries where I was going to go, which made it possible for me to do this. So I just, that's a little insight which I really thought I should mention. But anyway, so when I was doing that, going around Africa, learning about Africa's problems, learning about the problems of the people of Africa, realizing that a lot of them stemmed from the old colonial slave trade and the old colonial extraction of resources from Africa, leaving Africans poorer, and that many big corporations are doing exactly the same today. That's when I began this crazy 300 days a year traveling around the globe. And that's North America, South America, Asia, of course, Africa, and even the Middle East. And I was meeting these young people who didn't seem to have much hope for the future. And some of them were angry, even violent. Some of them were deeply depressed. Some of them, most of them, just apathetic. And I was talking to them, all these different parts of the world. They said more or less the same, you've compromised our future and there's nothing we can do about it. Well, every time I look at a small child, I feel ashamed of my species when I think of how we've harmed this planet since I was their age. Is it true there's nothing that can be done about it? As I've said, some scientists believe, no, there's nothing we can do. But to slow down climate change, to restore health to destroyed habitats, to save animal species, yes, we can do those things. And so I began this program called Roots and Shoots, and it began with 12 Tanzanian high school students who came to my house in Dar es Salaam to tell me about the things that bothered them in the environment around them. And right from the beginning, the main message of Roots and Shoots was every single individual matters, every single individual makes a difference every day. And these young people formed groups in their different schools. The 12 came from 9 high schools. They formed groups, and we had another meeting, and we planned, yes, every group will choose between them to do 3 projects to make the world a better place, one to help people, their own community, one to help animals, other animals, because we're animals too, actually, and one to help the environment we all share. Running through it all, emerged a theme of let's learn to live in peace and harmony, not only with each other, between nations, cultures, religions, but also between us and Mother Earth. And a program that began with these 12 high school students in Tanzania in 1991 is now in 140 countries. We have members from preschool through university, and we have about 100,000 active groups, in addition to which we have all the people who've been through Roots and Shoots in school or university, because we're preschool through university now, and they say once they've been involved in Roots and Shoots, it changes their vision, their philosophy, and it changes them for life. So building up to a critical mass of young people who understand what we have to do to make this a better world. And that includes understanding how each one of us, with the little choices that we make each day, make a difference, which when that is multiplied by millions and then billions of people making ethical choices, is going to lead to the kind of world that we all want for ourselves, our children and grandchildren. So Roots and Shoots is something I'm very passionate about. And you hear all the time young people can change the world, or you hear that they're responsible because it's their future. We're responsible. We have to help them to cope with the mess that we've created. And so when I travel around the world, where do I get energy to do all this? Because everywhere I go, there are young people with shining eyes wanting to tell Dr. Jane what they've been doing to make the world a better place. And it covers, I love all animals. JGI concentrates on chimpanzees. But through Roots and Shoots, everywhere I go, there are young people passionate about saving the elephants. And this includes people in China and Hong Kong and Singapore, where the demand is causing this terrible poaching. And there's a lovely piece of film I have which shows about 12 little girls, and they've all got placards up, and they're chanting, "Save our spiders, save our spiders." And the thing is that biodiversity means it's important to conserve spiders. We don't know what's going to happen when one spider species disappears or one little tiny insect goes, which happened to be the main food of a spider, which happened to be the main food of a bird, and so on. We're all interconnected, and gosh, you learn that in the rainforest. Everything in the rainforest is interconnected, the lungs of the world. So, Roots and Shoots. Yes, that's something I'm passionate about. And some of you today have said, what can people in the State Department do? Some of you have children. Please find out about Roots and Shoots, because it will change the life of your child, and that child will help to change the lives of others around. And by the way, some of them are raising large amounts of money to help the victims of earthquakes, hurricanes, and so forth. My next reason for hope, this, I talked about the development of the human intellect. Just think of the technologies, the innovative technologies that would enable us to live with clean, green energy if the subsidies that governments are putting for the fossil oil industry were used for this kind of clean, green energy. We'd be free of it. So much of the pollution. I'm sure some of you have been to Beijing, where they only have about 12 what they call blue sky days a year. It's horrible for human health. And agribusiness, with all the chemicals it sprays and genetically modified organisms and things like that. So our brain is coming up with ways to counteract all this. And sometimes it's going back to the past, like permaculture instead of monoculture, that sort of thing. And so the human brain is a huge reason for hope for me, the brain that each one of us has. And then there's the indomitable human spirit. There are people who tackle problems that seem impossible to tackle, but they won't give up. And I pick on an icon like Nelson Mandela, who came out of 17 years of physical labor with this amazing ability to forgive, so that he led his nation out of the evil regime of apartheid without a bloodbath. And then all around us, there are people who are overcoming social or physical problems which most of us would crumble under, and they are so inspirational. And so for the sake of these young people whose future we have harmed, we need to get together, and we have this amazing brain, we have the resilience of nature, And that indomitable human spirit, that's in every single one of us. We all have that same power to change the world around us, to inspire others, to lead a life that will create a future, not just for our children and theirs, but for the wildlife on this planet with whom we should be sharing the resources which we also must save. Thank you.
Left to have questions, to take a few questions. So if anybody would like to ask Dr. Goodall a question, please just line up at the microphones. And in the meantime, I have a question that was sent in from our Consulate General in Shanghai. And one of the questions I received was, what can a person do locally to improve women's health? Are we back?
Do I go back there? Oh, on my thing. Oh, I forgot it was there. I forgot I was mic'd up like that. What can people do? Well, it depends where you are. I mean, if you're a mother, there's all sorts of ways that you can learn about your child's health. I can't really answer that question because it's a bit vague, but let me say that we have a very major Roots and Shoots Jane Goodall Institute office in Shanghai. So I hope that maybe they could give some local advice. Maybe you can answer that question.
No, I would suggest that they hook up with the local Roots and Shoots organization. Does anybody else have any questions?
Hello, thank you very much for coming. How do you deal diplomatically with people who are maybe climate change deniers or people who say that mankind has nothing to do with it and just the way it is?
How do I deal with, could you all hear? Probably not. You could hear. Okay. Well, how do I deal with those people? They're a rather strange breed, I think. I've been to Greenland. I've stood by that great ice sheet that goes up to the cap, the ice cap of the world. I've stood there with Inuit elders who say that when they were young, this ice sheet did not melt even in the summer. Now this was very early spring, and the water was pouring out, and the ice, there was this great crashing of icebergs, icebergs carving as the huge chunks of ice fell down. And learning that if all that ice melted, and we mustn't let it, if it did, the level of the ocean would rise 11 feet. I don't know if those facts are exact, but that's what they told me. And I've seen the glacier on top of Mount Kilimanjaro disappear. All the glaciers are disappearing. And yes, they'll tell you there were cycles throughout evolution. That's true. There have been cycles of the ice age and then, you know, tropical times. But it's the speed with which it's happening. It's unprecedented. And it's very frightening. And we have to do what we can to slow it down. And that's why, hopefully, this conference in Paris will create some new impetus. I really hope it does. But, you know, a government can sign on, the president can sign, then he gets, the next president is elected and he overturns it. That's happened. So then how do we enforce the legislation that the leaders say that they will implement? How do we enforce it?
I wish I could tell you.
I know. That was a rhetorical question.
Another question, Deb?
Sure. Dr. Goodall, thanks again for coming to the State Department. Just last month, world leaders adopted a new set of development goals, sustainable development goals, and wondered your reactions to that agreement and how it what type of potential it has to advance some of the things that you've talked about here today. Thank you.
Well, I think it's very much the same as the last question, in a way, or the last comments that I made, because those agreements were those goals were set before, and very few of them have been reached in the time frame that was committed. So a new set, will it be any different? It really depends somehow on us, and there is one other thing going for us which can help in all of these different things, I think, and that is social media used in the right way. And I came to this understanding when I was part of the climate march this time last year in New York. And the organizers expected about 80,000 people, they hoped. And in fact, there were almost 400,000, and there would have been more, but the police had to close the roads for danger of people suffocating and trampling on each other. So what was happening? What made it suddenly grow like that? I saw and I heard. There were people all around me with their little cell phones and their tablets and their iPads, and they were tweeting and twittering and all these things that you do today, and they were talking. I heard one of them saying, come and join us, it's really great here, it's a lovely day, and there's a whole lot of film stars over there, DiCaprio's here. And then I heard one of them say, Jane Goodall's here. At any rate, so they came. I had to leave, and I met lots of people coming. And that was happening all over the world in major cities. It was the biggest gathering of people around a single issue in the history of man. So that's what we can do, whereas in the old days you could maybe gather a couple of hundred people, you'd call them and try and spread it by word of mouth. But now, instantly, if something goes viral, you can gather in hundreds of thousands, millions, billions of people. And that's an exciting thing that we can do. And, yeah.
Oh, yes, go ahead.
Hi, thanks very much for being here today. I just wanted to say that I think that the message that you and Tammy both emphasized of needing human-centered conservation is a really powerful one. And I wonder how we can be more effective at communicating and inspiring people in urban environments to spark the conservation ethic and get them involved in this.
Well, one of the things, my little tools, is the youth. And when I first introduced Roots and Shoots to the US, that was in 1994, I think it was. It was a conference at the UN. It was a memorial for Albert Schweitzer. And at the last minute, the organizers realized they didn't have anybody talking to one of his passions, which was, humanitarian action towards animals. Animals were a passion of his. And so they invited me to talk. And they said, Jane, you'll love it because there's a lot of young people coming. And so I said, oh, can I bring some young people? So this introduced Roots and Shoots to the US and internationally, because I had a group from Tanzania, from DRC, from Angola, from Congo, from the UK, and then there was the US group. And when it got going in the US, I thought, is it going to work in inner city the same as it does out in Africa? And so the first two places where I tried to introduce it, one was in South Central, oddly enough through the LAPD, and one was in the Bronx in the second poorest school in the nation. And to take the example from the Bronx, when I went back a year, I gave them a talk, not about Roots and Shoots, about chimpanzees and things. I gave them a talk, and I went back a year later to see if the little Roots and Shoots programs that the teachers began had worked. And there was a group of 16-year-old Latino. They were mostly African-American, but these were Latinos. And they had studied the effect of styrofoam on their school lunch boxes, the effect this would have on the environment, how long it would be, like thousands of years before the styrofoam disintegrated. And they did a little play, and it was so effective, they got rid of styrofoam from their school lunch boxes. They were asked to perform it in front of the mayor. And these children were really empowered, and they had parents. And so I think one of the ways to encourage people, one is to develop a program like Roots and Shoots, because these children will change their parents. I know so many parents who say, well, I have to recycle because the kids get mad at me if I don't, that sort of thing. And I have to turn the lights off. I have to not waste water, you know, because the kids are telling me. So that's one way. And another way is all of our Roots and Shoots programs, which I say go up to university, they have to be projects that are fun. If the kids don't have fun, then they're not going to do it. We have one wonderful one, which we've done in London, England, and also in Abu Dhabi. And it's a fashion show. And so the kids make a red carpet, and the fashion is all from recycled materials. And they make it from Coke bottle lids and all kinds, and some of it's gorgeous. You know, you almost could wear it in the street. But anyway, they have fun. So you have to motivate people, give them fun, let them see results. And perhaps most important of all, you made a difference.
I think we have time for just one more question.
Since different communities have different needs and you're in hundreds of countries, how do you go about helping alleviate poverty to then promote conservation in these diverse communities?
Well, I wouldn't try. The answer is what we did in Tanzania. You get a group of local people who are there, who do understand the problems, and you listen to them and get their advice. There is no way, I would presume, to go into any community anywhere and know what their problems are. I mean, even if you study it from a distance. So the answer is you use local people who do know everything and who are the ones most likely to give you the best advice as to how to spend your money, if you're lucky enough to have money to spend.
Thank you. I think we've run out of time. I want to thank all of you for coming, and we'll give a round of applause for our guests.